Hi. So we are here on my iPad Pro, and I thought I really knew there was a screen record function on the iPad, but I didn't know how to use it. And I kept scrolling down in my menu looking for it, assuming that it's not on the menu, so I don't have it. One Google search proved that I do have it. You have to add it to the menu. So here we are in Procreate. And I thought I'd do a quick like tutorial on kind of like a basic workflow. Now, Procreate, like any software, is completely and utterly open to your interpretation as an artist and your ideas as an artist once you kind of learn how to use the tools. The tools I've created with Procreate heavily represent the tools I probably would use in Photoshop and methods I would use in Photoshop or Coral Paint or methods I've picked up over years of doing digital painting. So here, and this is actually in real time. So here what I'm doing is just doing a little bit of sketching. I might speed it up, I'm not sure, but right now the voiceover that I'm doing is for a real-time video. So what I'm doing here is just going in, doing a sketch. Now, I don't want to toot my own horn. I'm quite a fast artist. I'm not a slow artist whatsoever. I think this drawing took 32 minutes with breaks in between. The breaks were for I was talking to my mum about some stuff and something's going on in the family, and I was just going back and forth. So I kind of took a few seconds here and there just to answer her questions and stuff. So as I said, usually this is a process that most people follow. Now I put down basic lines, and this brush probably wasn't good for lines. This brush I'm using here is more of a painting brush. So I just straight off my head, I thought let's create a quick character and let's kind of do some kind of like basic speed painting type stuff. You create a character, you create highlights, you create shadows and all those kind of things, and then you create a quick lighting scheme. And this, if I was doing speed paintings and stuff like that, or kind of quick visual development work, this is the type of stuff I would do. Now, this is more of like a cover image of a character just looking at the screen. A speed painting would be probably more like the character, and then maybe you'd have things like the character within a background, and then him within that background standing on the ground, and things in relation to his scale, things like that. This is more of a kind of like character portrait thing, kind of just done in the style of a speed painting, which is, sort of the thing that I do quite a lot. So here I am, just going in, throwing in my base color. Now, my base color isn't going to stay this color. Only the hair is going to stay this color, to be fair. I just throw a color down so I have it filled in. I could have done it multitudes of different ways. It could have been a lot quicker. I could have just gone around the outline of the body and the hair with one flat brush. This isn't even a flat brush. I'm having to really press down to get this brush to work. But I could have done it a few different ways within Procreate, but this is just the way I chose to do it. It's more fun if you actually interact with the pixels, I think, because Procreate is a painting tool, and it's nice to interact with, the painting tool aspect of Procreate. Now, what I do recommend though to all artists that use Procreate is try to customize it to be your tool set, because there's a few people that, out of the gate they can use it and they're okay with it. But me, when I started using it, I pretty much after, about a month of using it, I came to the conclusion that literally it's only going to be good for cell shading, and that's how I felt at that time. Now I'm a lot more optimistic because I've created so many different brushes. I've done so much different stuff within Procreate now that I'm way more optimistic than I was then. But that's the point. The point is it's because I did so much customizing, and I was inspired by other artists, and I carried on using that inspiration to up my skill set with Procreate itself. And that's something that I found to be quite important. Now, what I do recommend as well is, realizing that Procreate is more limited than Photoshop, but then in certain ways it has advantages. So, for example, its perspective guides are way better than Photoshop. They're incredible. If you want to do some stuff in perspective, even basic perspective layout, even if you don't stick to it, its perspective guides are seriously good. But then it has a lot of disadvantages, like the access to, you know, shortcut keys and certain tools that you don't have. There's a lot of editing and filters and stuff that you don't have, things that could be really useful. One that comes to mind is the camera raw filter, which I always use to adjust my colors in my images because I'm a photographer as well. So it kind of, it comes through nicely sometimes when you do an image, but it doesn't matter. You know, it's down to the basics, art tool, and it still is really useful. And the funny thing is, when I was saying all this crazy stuff about, you know, not being able to use Procreate that well, a month before this or something, or in the first month of having it, I created a digital painting that was like damn near the same quality as most things I've created in Photoshop. Straight off the bat, it was called Big Lug. It was like a giant. I drew like this giant kind of creature. And it was, you know, it's really realistic, decent quality and everything. And but it just didn't, it just wasn't the same experience. And I think that's what it was. And brushes, Procreate brushes aren't the same as Photoshop brushes. They have a little bit of a different feel to them. And they, the brush engine itself is a little bit different. So you find yourself kind of feeling out of water if you've used Photoshop for a long time. But then there's ways around that. There's ways to make very similar brushes. So for example, the round brush in Procreate doesn't feel anything like the round brush in Photoshop. It just doesn't feel the same. And that is an issue to start out with. But then you can solve that by editing the brush, you know. So here you see me using this square brush. Now this brush, I call it the chalkboard flat. This brush actually is one I made a while ago and I don't even use it now. But, and excuse my phone, that's a Facebook message. But I don't even use it now. I only use it sometimes. I've literally made a whole new set of brushes that I didn't really get to show off in this tutorial, but I'll probably show in the next one. But you know, I've made so many brushes though over the past 2 months. I've just been making brushes all the time that it's like it's got to a point where I can't even complain about the brush system in Procreate because it's been versatile enough for me to create brushes that work exactly how I want them to. And then a flip side, another advantage of Procreate, an advantage of having an actual iPad Pro, I don't know how it works on the iPad Mini, is that the smudge tool on the iPad Pro is phenomenal. Like, I can go in and smudge things almost instantaneously, whereas in Photoshop, smudging was hard. Smudging was difficult on your GPU, on your CPU, depending on how much RAM you had. It wasn't ideal to smudge stuff like it is in Procreate. In Procreate, it's just a fluid part of the process. It might as well just be called the blender, and it lets you kind of blend things a certain way. If you know how, if you have the right edges on your brush. So right now I've kind of stopped. If you look at the video, this is probably one of those times when I took a break or I went to talk to my mom or whatever it was. I think I'm back now. But as you can see, I've got the flat colors down, almost all of them. I've added a little bit of shadow on his cheeks to show that there's light there. That's like, I call this neutral. This is neutral coloring. So I'm not really thinking about a light source. I'm just doing neutral stuff. So when it comes to actually adding my light sources, I can. So it's a technique I see a lot in animation. People like Pascal Campion use techniques like this. So what happens is you create a separate layer, and on that separate layer, you add your shadows. And that doesn't happen until later on in the process, but you'll see it. Because before that, I had a background and everything. I say this because I literally just painted this. I exported the file, not exported the file. I waited for the file to show up in my gallery. And I brought this into iMovie and now I'm editing it. So literally did it 5 minutes before doing the voiceover. But an important thing to remember is if you stay, you know, neutral within your shading and your coloring in this stage, then you can add lighting and shadows later on that will be very convincing. Because in the real world, things are very much augmented by how they're lit and how the shadows work and where they are and the color of the shadows. Think about when you go to a nightclub, if you've ever been to a nightclub, and you see, or if you've ever been to like a prom or anything, when they turn the lights down and the lights come on, they have colored lights. Look how much the colored lights affect how you visually are represented color wise. So what I wanted to say was the light, the sun is going down behind him, but it's going down behind him at a certain degree where it still catches itself on the side of him. But then he's basically, because the sun's going down and it's catching him on one side, he's basically still in shadow on his other side. And that's what I wanted to represent. Now, I didn't go 100% realism. I didn't look at any reference. I just quickly went through it for the sake of this tutorial, because it was really more about how you work in Procreate and how you make things work. And obviously, I know there's a lot of videos about Procreate work processes, but it's always nice to throw your two cents in and enter the game as a new player. And that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to enter this Procreate game because I've really been using Procreate almost exclusively. And I'm a man who has access to Corel Painter and Photoshop. And they are, you know, they have been my staples, but Procreate is very quickly becoming one of my favorite pieces of software simply because of how customizable it is, simply because I can take it anywhere. You know, I've created studies on Procreate that are damn near realistic. I've done so many things. It's customizable. That's the thing about it. And it's easy to use, and there's not that much of a curve, you know, there's not much of a learning curve in comparison to learning Photoshop. Because learning Photoshop was not easy because of all its functions, and you get caught up in all of that. Procreate has 4 tools, you know, brush, smudge, rubber, and layers. And then your color tool at the end, so I guess 5, and then it has the other things on the other side next to the gallery box. So it's really, really intuitive for artists, and it's gonna change the world. You know, I hope Adobe comes strong with their iPad product. I hope it's the same kind of level of intuitiveness, because I've used Artist Studio Pro, which is basically a Photoshop clone, and it doesn't hold a candle to Procreate. The only advantage it has is that you can bring in your Photoshop brushes, so it's a lot closer to Photoshop, but it's nowhere near as intuitive as Procreate. So I've just decided not to use it now. Also, it doesn't record your images as well as Procreate. I've had a lot of errors come from Artist Studio Pro when trying to record and export my videos from that software. So that's a bit upsetting, but other than that, it's okay, I guess. It's just not as good as Procreate. But the big issue with, these types of pieces of software, and put Procreate and Photoshop in the same categories. Procreate essentially is a Photoshop clone that doesn't want to own up to it. It's very similar to Photoshop. It paints very similar to Photoshop. I say this because I've been a Corel Painter user since 2009. And Corel Painter has been superior in terms of its brushes, its blending, straight out of the box to all of these softwares since that time. It's always been a step ahead. So has things like Clip Studio Paint that used to be called Manga Studio. They've been ahead, right? And why have they been ahead? Because they offer blending, which is a painterly option. Artists blend, paint, real paint blends. Photoshop is like painting with acrylics. It doesn't really blend. It's more of a build-up. You're more building up colors on top of each other than actually painting and blending like you would with traditional media. Now, you can use similar techniques sometimes if you lower your opacity and stuff, but you cannot blend properly unless you use the smudge tool. Now, that's where Procreate has an advantage, as I've said, depending on if you have an iPad Pro or whatever it is. But the iPad Pro I have, the newest one, is powerful enough that if I want to use the smudge tool every single time I put down some paint strokes to blend them together, I can, which is a huge advantage if you're trying to create digital artwork and you're trying to make it look painterly and convincing, especially when you can use all your alphas all your brush alphas from Photoshop and stuff. And that's what I do. I go on Photoshop or whatever software I have, and I take a stamp of the brush I use and I bring it into Procreate and I adjust it to whatever settings that one of my favorite brushes is at the time. And that's what I do. And I've spent a while doing that, and there's still many brushes I want to bring in. Like I just brought in Kekai Kotoki's brush, because I remember when I was a kid, I watched Kekai Kotoki. Kekai Kotoki used to work at, on Guild Wars, by the way. He's this concept artist. He's really good. He does like really good fantasy art. And he had a brush that he put on screen. And I remember screen recording the video and taking the brush and, you know, sharpening it and everything. And, you know, next minute I had Kekai Kotoki's brush. And I just remember this brush was like a dream, and it literally had no special things to it. It was just a shape. But the way it was, the way it had a blurred edge and then it had hard and soft edges on this one brush, using it was literally a dream. It created these really nice brush marks. I've just brought that into Procreate. But as I was saying, sorry, I had to cut my recording. As I was saying, I took Kekai Kotoki's brush and it makes these really good brush strokes. And, you know, in the end of the day, you have to, as I said at the start, make it customizable for yourself. Make it work for yourself. Do what works for you. Because when you look at artists on the higher levels, other than like Anthony Jones, who's just really proficient at using the round brush, everyone uses their own custom setups, you know, and it might only be five brushes. One of my favorite artists, Alexander Zedig de Buon, he would use brush sets of like five brushes for everything, and they would look fantastic. And this, you know, this guy doesn't even do paintings anymore. He does like cel shaded stuff. But when he was doing paintings, it was just beautiful. You know, it's just beautiful, digital, kind of like these really cool character designs and stuff. And we're like the same age. And I remember just being inspired like to hell by this guy. So just remember, you know, it's always about figuring out what tools work for you. I remember when I was, I had a Windows machine from 2008 to about 2012 or 13. I'd say, no, 2013, right? I had this Windows computer, this Windows laptop, and it was a Dell Inspiron 1720. When I got it in 2008, it was pretty strong. And then I remember going forward in time, and when Photoshop CS4 and CS5 came out, with all of those, it had this weird brush lag. So I went back to Photoshop CS2 for everything, because I didn't like the brush lag. I didn't like the fact my process was being messed with. So doing that allowed me to kind of like scale back what brushes I was using. And then I started using brushes, like customizing my own brushes. And a brush I really enjoyed using was the chalk brush in Photoshop. It comes with Photoshop. And I'd squished it to make it thinner, put it on its side. So it was like a chalk elliptical kind of like brush. It was really cool. And I used it for absolutely everything. Everything. I had a textured version and a non-textured version. And that was literally the brush I used for a whole year or something. And I just remember, you know, sorry if you can hear my mum laughing in the background. She, you know, she does that. That's one of her things. But it was just about, that was my brush set. And I really enjoy using those brushes. And they kind of gave me some of my favorite pieces up to today. Still pieces I look back on from 2012. It's 2019. And I'm like, that was cool. Because I don't use that brush set anymore. And that's like a lot of artists. Zedig doesn't really use the same sets he used to use. Because he doesn't really do stuff now with texture. If anyone really watches Zedig, let me know if he does. But last time I checked his page, his Tumblr, everything, he doesn't really use texture. He does more kind of cartoony stuff with cell shading and stuff like that now. Very kind of Studio Ghibli-esque type stuff. But I was inspired by his more painterly stuff, and that was kind of that was kind of what I wanted to kind of try to replicate, because I just looked at it and I thought to myself, is it even possible to replicate what this guy's doing? Because it just looked so beautiful, you know, and it was digital art. And then he released a tutorial on Gumroad. And this tutorial came out before he started doing cel shader stuff. But I remember getting the tutorial and there was one brush. Now, this is crazy. One brush in that set that absolutely changed my life. And I still use it today. Not so much because I'm in Procreate and it doesn't really translate over to Procreate that well. But this brush, and I call it the Z-Dig chalk. It's got a weird name. Not the Z-Dig chalk. Z-Dig rake. It's, you know, this brush. And this is meant to be a tutorial, but I'm just talking about brushes. Well, what I will say is, I'll get back to the brush in a sec. So what I've done since I've started talking about brushes, now, as I said, I've gone in, I've made my lighting scenario happen. I've done all of these things. I've added a little bit of a background, very loose. It's just a shape, but it adds suggestion for your mind. It could be a gate. It could be a building. Who knows? Some kind of structure behind him. And I'm adding shadows on an overlay layer. And I've got highlights. And I've gone in and I've warmed up those shadows because everything in the frame is warm except for him. So it'd be hard for the shadows to be that cool with so much warm ambient light. And ambient light's another thing. But anyway, back to the Z-Dig brush. So this brush Z-Dig used to use, it would have a very texture wash effect, which would seem very, very, very painterly because of the shape of the brush, because of how it moved, and because of the dual brush feature that was applied to it that you can do in Photoshop, which you can't yet do in Procreate, which is a feature where you can put two brushes together in it. It kind of uses, it's very strange, I can't explain it, but it uses the two brushes in tandem. And that brush really made me think about, like, whoa, because he was using this brush the whole time, and I was thinking, that's how we get such cool looking stuff, because the stuff was just looking so painterly. And so it's like a lot of things you can do with a round brush, but round brushes aren't realistic. You don't have a round brush in the real world. Your brush has bristles, you know, and it's not until you start making brushes with bristles that you understand that, well, actually, yeah, most brushes people use have bristles. And then if they don't have bristles, like this brush I've been using, a lot of brushes are used in the real world are flat and they have a very square look when you put them down. They create like square shapes. And you have to realize that that round brush isn't really a realistic thing in the real world. It's more like a pen. You can get round pens, but even those aren't really round when they're applied. They're usually applied at a point, so they're more like squares, you know, and it's very strange. So what I'm saying is, the round brush, the way that a lot of people start painting in Photoshop and stuff, is very unnatural. It's a very unnatural looking brush. And it doesn't have any texture or anything. So if you apply it on its own, it just looks like a semi-opaque digital line. And that's the issue with it. That's why it's always good to have different shapes. That's why the Kekai brush and the Z-Dig brush and all these other brushes have so much value in Photoshop. And Photoshop can't even blend, or it is not even a painterly app. When you use Painter in comparison to Photoshop, it just blows Photoshop out of the water because it actually is a painting app. It's built to paint and create marks and texture, and it's interact with the colors that are already down, and it's so insane in comparison. But there are ways to cheat Photoshop into creating those looks that are similar, not the same, but similar to Painter. You know, and some might even say you can create better looks sometimes in Photoshop. I would agree and disagree. I'd say Painter is just, for most people, is going to be far better. But for some specific artists that have built their whole thing using Photoshop, I'd say stick to Photoshop. But anyway, look, so right now I'm at a stage where I've started using the ambient occlusion brush, I believe. Now, what my ambient occlusion brush is, if you don't know what ambient occlusion is, it's the shadow areas that we get under overlaps and in forms. So under, you know, under your head, there'll be ambient occlusion.
because your head casts a shadow on your neck. Where your ears fold over, there'll be ambient occlusion because it casts a shadow on your ears. When you wrinkle your face, there'll be ambient occlusion in those wrinkles because they'll cast a shadow. And that's what ambient occlusion is. Now, ambient occlusion is interesting because it's that sometimes it is make or break. Adding ambient occlusion to an image can push it from flat to being quite depthy. And that's what's happened here. It looks like it's gotten sharper. It has, because I've added these lines that bump up the level of like detail. So what it is, it's a brush with a hard edge and a soft edge on the other side. And you use whichever side works to get the right ambient occlusion. And that's what I do. I'm not sure if I'll put my brushes in the description box because I have loads of different sets of brushes. I'm going to have to make one master set. But if people are interested, I will put my brushes online. I don't care if people use them. I'm not interested in any of that. I just want people to get better. I want there to be more people in Procreate. I want there to be more people creating. But as I said, I'm just using ambient occlusion to go in, add details, add abs. You know, now I'm adding his chest muscles. Now here, when I'm adding his chest muscles, literally, I just pulled it down. So it's kind of like, if anyone's ever used ZBrush, and I'm probably preaching to the wrong choir, but in ZBrush, there used to be a brush called the Damn Standard. Well, there still is, but it used to be a brush you had to download. Now the Damn Standard brush comes with ZBrush because it's that popular. That many people use it that ZBrush made it official. I wish Photoshop would do the same thing with some brushes. I wish Procreate would do the same thing. But, you know, we'll have to wait for that at some point. But literally, it's similar to the Damn Standard. It kind of adds a certain sharp edge to things. You know, as you can see here, I'm working on the hair, just throwing in little bits of ambient occlusion just to create detail. It's really good for detail too. So it's just impressive what you can end up doing with it. So just keep that in mind, you know. But as I said before, I created this tutorial just to show workflow. You know, just to show people a way to work in Procreate. Sometimes I just go in and just paint stuff. Now, one disadvantage of Procreate that I don't like is the fact that there's always a color layer underneath everything you paint. It's very strange. You can't paint on the background layer. The background layer is always an individual color layer and you can't even access it. But I get it. It's still a good feature that you can always adjust your background color. I do like that. But at the same time, it's strange when you've worked in Photoshop and you can just work on your background. Because I usually just open Photoshop documents and just work straight on the background layer as is. So that's strange. But other than that, you know, Procreate is, you know, it's a great piece of software. It's way better than you'd expect for an iPad app. But then I've done research and gone back, and people like Nikolai Lockheron, who uses it, I think that's how you say his name. Sorry if I butchered it. He does really good stuff with environments. He's a really good artist in general. He's been using Procreate for like 6 years. I think one of his videos was 8 years old from back before it had an Apple Pencil, like years ago. Back when it had, like, you know, he had to get styluses and use a different iPad, not even an iPad Pro. So, you know, Procreate's been, people have been working on it for a long time. And I guess the people that got in early, like Nikolai, have just had, you know, the best time learning about it and helping Procreate grow into a tool that's useful. But yeah, also I've downloaded brushes. I downloaded, I don't know his name, Max. He, his brushes are called Max Packs. I can't remember his name. Honestly, I wasn't that impressed with the brushes and I haven't used them that much. But maybe that's just because I haven't used them that much. Or maybe it's just because I enjoy my own brush styles, but I wasn't super impressed by them. I thought I was going to get something that was going to blow me out of the water, but that I honestly feel like they're for a specific feeling. They're for a specific scenarios. That's the problem with those brushes. They're not kind of like versatile for every scenario. They're for specific scenarios. So, you know, if you want to add some kind of like color variation, you know, maybe get one of the brushes with holes in it and kind of scratch on the other side. stuff like that. But I haven't really found them to be that useful. But I've only got the painter set. I don't have the gouache set, which is the new set, which is meant to be the daddy of the sets. I haven't got that set simply because I don't want to pay. I'd rather make my own brushes, to be honest. I'm enjoying it now. I'm enjoying making brushes. It's part of my everyday process. It's something that, you know, I'm finding that I'm just making new brushes for every scenario now. Like yesterday I was thinking, because I used to be inspired by a guy called Stefan Sajic. He calls himself Nebezio on DeviantArt. Since I've started drawing in 2009, since I started taking drawing serious, he's been inspirational and still is today. He still has really, really cinematic, beautiful work. And this guy uses Photoshop and uses really hard brushes, turns the opacity down to like 50%, and then, you know, does it. But in Procreate, turning the opacity down doesn't have the same effect as it does in Photoshop. So my plan is to do the same stuff he does, similar stuff, similar style, but just use a 50% layer and then blend everything together at the end. But yeah, it's another situation where the limitations of Procreate or the strangeness of Procreate kind of got in the way of something, but I'm not giving up. I'm going to figure it out. But yeah, if you guys haven't seen Nebezio's work, my God, this guy's a problem. This guy is just, it's so good. Everything he does is just beautiful. Like, he's just so, the style he's developed is just so powerful. And I'm so much in support of that guy, more than a lot of other artists, just because I've watched him do what he does for so long. But anyway, guys, it seems like I've talked the life out of you guys and I'm at the end. So thank you for watching. It was a pleasure. If you watched, please like and subscribe. Comment if you want to. I'll be back with more tutorials. I'll be back with a free brush pack, and I'll do another video on that brush pack, maybe a 10-minute video just on kind of like ways to use those brushes. I hope I keep up with this video stuff because I love it, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace.